Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee this session. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn, and I'm pleased to say Evelyn Tweed is attending in her place. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is on the third sector recovery. Third sector organisations have been recognised rightly and celebrated for their innovative and fast response to the challenges posed by COVID-19. However, the pandemic has also inflicted real damage, and today the committee will look at the longer term resilience of the third sector and the challenges it faces. We'll hear from two panels today. I welcome the first from Paul Bradley, Policy and Public Affairs Manager at the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, Martin Tyson, Head of Regulation and Improvement, the Office of the Charity Regulator, Kia Chahinska, Senior Development Officer of TSI Scotland Network, and Duncan Thorpe, Policy and Public Affairs Manager at Social Enterprise Scotland. Welcome to you all. So I would like to invite colleagues around the table to ask their series of questions, and first up is Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us, and also thank you for your submissions in advance, which were incredibly helpful. I just want to put on record to my thanks to the third sector for everything that you've done in this year in particular, but also before that. Having spent a number of my working life in the third sector, I know how hard you work and how important it is, so I just want to put that on record. In some of the evidence that we received, it was really, really clear to me that the impact of the last year on not just the services that you deliver, but also the jobs that you have and you create has been significant. And in some cases, you note that some organisations have been really struggling and have had to make some painful operating decisions. Could you tell us a little bit about that, and also about the redundancies and how many jobs you think could have been affected by the past year and a half?
Could you suggest who you'd like your question to go to first, please?
Thank you. Yes, please. Could I direct that to Paul Bradley from SCVO first, please? Thanks.
Of course. Thank you, Pam. And thank you to the committee for inviting us along today. I think the impact of the pandemic, overall, I would say that the sector has coped remarkably well over the course of the past 16 or 18 months. And I don't think that is too surprising, given that the sector operates in an environment that is always uncertain, and we're always unsure with what's going to come next in terms of funding and resource and support. But I think it is really important, and I want to stress that today, that while the sector has shown itself to be resilient over the course of the past 18 months, that resilience shouldn't be taken for granted. The sector was already in a vulnerable position before the pandemic, as Pam just mentioned there. The outlook for the sector back in 2019 and just before the pandemic was uncertain as well. And SCBO State of the Sector Survey picked that up back then. I think our recent research through the Scottish Third Sector Tracker has shown that nearly all organisations were impacted by the pandemic in some way. That survey revealed that 98% faced challenges since the start of the pandemic, 88% experienced disruptions to service delivery, and roughly half experienced financial issues. And on that specific point, in terms of redundancies, 9% of the organisations we surveyed, which is around 600 organisations in total, 9% of those had to make staff redundancies. And we know that obviously there's significant support for the Scottish voluntary sector provided by the Scottish Government. That was really welcome, particularly the Third Sector Resilience Fund. And that undoubtedly saved thousands of jobs in terms of ensuring that organisations could keep the lights on. And the furlough scheme as well was hugely important. I think our research showed recently that 29% of organisations made use of the furlough scheme. And one in 10 still had people on furlough during the summer. I would say, though, that actually, while we expected that to be a significant challenge for the voluntary sector when furlough was lifted, that hasn't come through to fruition. And actually, one of the biggest issues we face now is around recruitment. And SCVO's Good Moves jobs portal has had its busiest autumn on record in terms of putting jobs up there to recruit for.
Thank you very much for that. Could I ask an additional question, if that's okay? What could we do as a parliament, as a government, to support the third sector going forward to make sure that we can maintain those jobs within the sector and ensure fair work practices?
Yes. Well, I think the biggest challenge has to be the short-term funding cycle that many organisations face within the sector, and I'm sure you'll hear about that from the rest of the panel and the second panel. It's that short-term cycle that is really hard to keep staff in post. I was speaking to organisations recently who are really struggling to recruit staff when they're only able to offer six-month contracts if it's kind of midway through the year. Also, staff who are on short-term contracts like that will always be looking for other roles for their own job security. So I think that long-term funding is absolutely vital to provide security to staff. But also, I think there's an issue around the challenges that leaders in organisations face. You know, the pandemic has put a lot of pressure on senior leaders, and I know COSBO have done quite a bit of research and looking into the well-being of senior leaders. And I'm sure there are plenty that are thinking about their next move and whether they want to stay in the sector because of the stresses that are put upon them as leaders in terms of navigating those kind of choppy waters that their workforce encounter. I think also a big one will be around the need for inflationary uplifts. I spoke to organisations recently that haven't had an inflationary uplift for between 6 to 12 years. And if you think about the cost of living and the increase since then, even just in the last year, you know, that's a huge impact on organisations that aren't necessarily always able to dip into their reserves and the other resources that they have available to top up those wages.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Paul. I'm conscious of the fact that what you said there around the level of organisations of your members, Paul, that had accessed furlough, which seemed a very small number, would that be because of, compared to the other areas of society, would that be because of the very heavy lifting that the third sector did during COVID, providing services to communities across Scotland? Martin Tyson, I think, wants to come in here.
Yes, sorry, thanks. I was really just wanting to amplify a point that Paul made, and that was about you know, the slightly longer term funding. I think part of the importance of that, and part of the importance, for instance, in supporting employment in the sector, is the ability of charities to build up reserves. There's some evidence that charities went into the pandemic with some quite low levels of reserve, particularly smaller charities. And the ability to build up reserves would really help the resilience of the sector.
Thanks very much, Martin. Paul or another member of the panel, does anyone have any reflection on the fact that, to me, that figure on the number of organisations utilising furlough seemed low? And that seems to suggest to me that a number of these organisations were having to keep their operations pretty steady throughout the pandemic. Is that an accurate reflection?
Yeah, so I think in terms of SCVO's work, that's one survey, and I'm not sure if other panel members will be able to kind of dip into other surveys that they've published. But absolutely, the voluntary sector has been on the front line during the whole of the pandemic, and I think it's shown that the Scottish Government's kind of initial package of £350 million highlighted the recognition that the public sector wouldn't be able to meet the needs of people in communities without voluntary organisations, charities and other groups there in communities. And I think that resilience funding, which I think totaled to around £22 million from the Scottish Government to keep the lights on in charities, would have been hugely hugely helpful for organisations that were cash strapped. But as I say, voluntary organisations are on the front line, and I think many of our organisations will have experienced probably the busiest periods that we've had in the lifetime.
You're absolutely right, and I take my hat off to everybody that continued to do work and provide service throughout the pandemic, putting themselves at risk in order to help others across society. It was an incredible effort that's still going on in communities across Scotland. I wonder if Kia or Paul might be able to reflect on one of the positive aspects of the pandemic in terms of the third sector, and that has been the anecdotal spike in volunteering that has taken place across Scotland, with people really giving their time and services to local organisations. Is there evidence to support that anecdotal suggestion? Kia.
Absolutely. So within the TSI network, especially throughout the Ready Scotland campaign, there has been a huge, huge spike in volunteering. So we don't necessarily, because we're locally based, we don't have the statistics across the country. But just for illustration, for Edinburgh, I'm just going to quickly look it up. For Edinburgh, 5,550 people have signed up. Five to four volunteers have been onboarded to the Community Task Force program, which supported people with things like prescription deliveries and those kind of frontline supports. And this continues today. So there has been seen a small number of decrease to 446 volunteers up until now, as of yesterday. But I would still say, you know, that especially during the initial stages of the pandemic, there has been a huge, huge interest in volunteering. And even though with the furlough scheme finishing and with people going back to work, we have seen some drop of in volunteering so far. But it's still a lot higher than it used to be before. And I think what we need to think about is how do we build on that coming out of the pandemic. And this is obviously an Edinburgh example, but it was all very, very similar across the country. So for example, for East Dunbartonshire, it was 835 people who signed up for the Ready Scotland campaign, 500 replied, and then I think 384 were placed into supporting communities via mutual aid groups. So there has been a huge volunteer effort. And I think probably in terms of resilience, what we need to think about is how do we build on that? And apart from local support that TSI so far, apart from Volunteer Scotland support, I do wonder how do we can build towards a national effort around that.
Absolutely. I can see Paul Bradley's looking to come back in. Paul, is that the reflection from SCVO as well? Is that spike likely to be because people have found more time on their hands due to furlough? They'll be able to give more of their time? And how do we harness that positive aspect of what's happened during the pandemic going forward to encourage people to keep supporting their local third sector organisations?
Of course. Yeah, I mean, the voluntary sector relies heavily on volunteers even before the pandemic. I think nearly three quarters of voluntary organisations in 2019 was run solely by volunteers. So it's actually a much smaller percentage that rely on a paid workforce. I think the pandemic, as Kaya's mentioned and others will say, that obviously there was a huge spike in interest in terms of volunteering, and some of that came about through, I guess, people having more time, but also I think just Scotland's nature in terms of wanting to be part of volunteerism. And I think before the pandemic, at least informally, 1.4 million people could be classed as volunteers, and obviously that has increased, especially through informal volunteering. I think one of the issues, though, that voluntary organisations would have faced is that they weren't able to place every single person that wanted to volunteer during the pandemic. There was a huge increase through the kind of Scotland Cares initiative to try and drum up volunteering. And actually, I think what we saw is that the emergency need for volunteering and that kind of support was very well matched with infrastructure that was already in place. And I think it goes to show the importance of fostering and investing in infrastructure before crises hit. But I do think voluntary organisations did a remarkable role in allocating volunteer placements where they could. I thought it was quite interesting, though, again, through the survey that SCVO, the longitudinal survey that SCVO have been sponsoring, is that despite that, that expected increase in informal volunteering, which is quite hard to capture, 36% of organisations surveyed as part of that tracker reported a decrease in the number of volunteers they usually work with. And only 17% had increased the number of volunteers they work with across this time. And I think part of that, especially if we look at the formal volunteering stuff, supporting formal volunteering is not free. It costs, and there has to be infrastructure in place. You need effective volunteer managers that can provide support for people in positions, particularly those who require further additional support. And we know from the Scottish Volunteering Forum that economic pressures have led to some of those volunteer management roles in organisations going missing after the pandemic through redundancies, and during the pandemic, some of those being placed on furlough as well. So it's not a complete picture. Absolutely, we've seen a rise in kind of that informal volunteering, but from organisations that rely on volunteers, you know, all of the time, the survey currently suggests that there's been a decrease in terms of volunteers that they're able to support.
Thank you very much, Paul. Before I bring in Marie McNair, I can see that Duncan Thorpe and Kaya Shahinska wish to come back in again briefly. Duncan Thorpe.
Hi there, yeah. Yeah, so firstly, thanks for the invitation today. I'd like to echo what's already been said to start with. I think in terms of the voluntary sector, I think that's patterns are reflected in the social enterprise community as well. I think that's fair to say. I think there are a lot of predictions around you know, catastrophic impacts on third sector organisations in terms of jobs, in terms of survival of organisations. But I think that's not happened in reality in the sense that Scottish Government funding, furlough funding, etc. was put in place, I think, quite quickly. And yeah, that's all credit to government and ourselves as a sector for getting that funding in place. I think we do need to look at, I suppose, long-term recovery. So a lot of organisations have survived, they have retained staff, and they are working in communities across the country already. But I think we need to look at, you know, the longer-term impacts, perhaps. Perhaps it's time to survey and do a bit of research around that, around what that might mean for third sector organisations around, and in terms of the longer-term impacts of the lockdown period.
Kia?
First of all, I would just like to echo Paul's point in terms of volunteering, in terms of investment in voluntary management. And I think this is a foundation on which good volunteering practices can be built, because the volunteers can be supported within their roles. But also, I would like to touch on the barriers. So I think Paul has mentioned that some of the formal volunteering has reduced. And in some cases, this is due to the fact that some of the volunteers were shielding they were from the older demographic. And I think what we also need to consider is how do we support people who are shielding or are still sometimes shielding, or are experiencing other barriers to come back to volunteering, and to ensure that that they can support the charitable sector. And I think part of that is to do with investment in voluntary management and ensuring that volunteer managers are equipped and skilled helping organizations to address those barriers. But also in some cases, I think it may be investment in practical, supporting organizations with practical issues of reducing those barriers. So, for example, you know, in terms of disabled people, sometimes charities don't have funds to make adjustments that are needed, or in other cases as well. I think there are, I guess, two different bit. One is the investment in voluntary management, and also making sure that organisations are equipped to support volunteers the best they can.
Thank you very much indeed. Marie McNair, please.
The volunteer part. I mean, I think we need to do all we can to break down the barriers associated with volunteering. I think we heard recently about the barriers people are facing on universal credit when they're trying to volunteer. The Scottish Government have acted in several ways to support the third sector during the pandemic. In your view, what has worked well and what can be improved? And also, going forward, what good lessons can we learn for the future? I'll post that to Duncan. Thanks.
Yes, as I've mentioned, I think we were pleasantly surprised and pleased, I think, with the kind of response from not just government, but non-government funders as well, in terms of, you know, really just getting money into social enterprise and third sector bank accounts quite quickly. I think there was a kind of initial shock period, I think, where organisations were, you know, felt they were in crisis at least. But I think that funding did actually reach people quite quickly, so I think that worked really well. I think going forward, if we do look at, you know, a similar kind of situation and what didn't work, I think there were a number of barriers in terms of social enterprise community at least. I would say startups and pre-startups, I think, fell through the cracks a bit in terms of funding support. There was an organisation that I spoke to, they were about to launch just the week after lockdown, and it was a case of, they literally couldn't access any type of funding. I think they did actually end up reverting to universal credit as the only source of funding they could access. And I think there's an ongoing issue maybe for community interest companies that are a key type of social enterprise. I think community interest companies are facing barriers in general, I think, in terms of funding from maybe non-government sources in particular. So I think there are a number of organizational types that I think fell through the cracks in terms of funding, but I think overall, as I said, we didn't face that kind of, you know, catastrophic kind of situation which we thought we might face, because I think that the funding did, on the whole, kind of reach bank accounts quite quickly. And I think non-government funders were really good as well in terms of pivoting and adapting the grants that they've given out to organisations and saying, look, we said you need to spend it on this particular project, but in the circumstances, you can spend it on something else. And I think it's the case with local authorities as well. There was very much a flexibility, I think, which wasn't particularly there before.
Yep, anybody else can answer that?
Paul Bradley, you'd like to come in here.
Yes, just briefly, I want to echo the point about independent funders as well. And it's the first time SCVO have really worked so actively with independent funders over the course of the pandemic to really kind of share learning and experiences and look at where there are needs and how funds could be adapted and how people could be supported through that. So that's been really positive. And hopefully that can continue. I think the Scottish Government support for the sector was fairly rapid and strategic. And I think the fact that £350 million package was announced in March, well before the UK government announced any funding for voluntary organisations, you know, resilience or support through equivalent wellbeing funds for people and communities, is a really positive thing, and it's great that recognition was there that we could play a vital role and that the infrastructure was there to do that. I think there was on the positive side of things that trust in voluntary in sector infrastructure to really understand its communities, understand organisations, whether that's at a national or local level, and trusting them to help design systems and processes and procedures to get funding to where it was needed most was, I think, a huge success. Of course, there's room for learning, and that's what we're here to do today and other sessions too. But I do think that sense of partnership between the Scottish Government, SCVO, funders, third sector interfaces and others around things like the shared funding platform that the SCVO set up along with partners was hugely important in terms of streamlining the application process, making it more accessible, but also just that partnership working that's needed at a time of crisis to share information and build systems and that are going to be agile enough to get funding to where it's needed most. I think also like I say, using existing infrastructure really important. I think the speed was also important. I think the Scottish Government pivoted its funds based on needs. So obviously we started with the third sector resilience fund and the wellbeing fund. So the resilience fund was all about keeping the lights on. The wellbeing fund was about getting small sums of money at the start out to people and communities who are most in need, you know, supplies and so on. And then later on in the programme, we had the Adapt and Thrive Fund, which is about supporting organisations to adapt their services for the long term throughout the pandemic. And I think really overall, each organisation really just played to their strengths. And I think it's an example of where barriers are kind of dropped and egos are dropped and people work together for a clear outcome. In terms of what worked less well, I think speaking to kind of our funding managers, it was clear that I think the split, and I think we have to be really careful when we talk about things that didn't work so well because of all the great things that did work well and at such pace. But I think the split between funds that were, say, the resilience fund that was keeping the lights on, the wellbeing funds that was about getting money to voluntary organisations to support people, actually created kind of two different application systems. And actually, would there have been a better way of doing that? I guess the benefit of hindsight is something that's nice. Also, I think that there was some confusion on the ground about different funds that were available. Some funds are open, some funds weren't open. Some funds were kind of allocated through prior knowledge of organisations in local areas. I'm not saying that that is a bad thing, but I think that transparency around some of that could have been improved, perhaps. And linked to that, I think the reflections was because of the different funds managed by different parts of government. So the funds that SCVO worked closely with were run by the third sector unit, but there are others across government. And it maybe felt at times that it wasn't someone behind the scenes within government actually joining all those dots together because of the kind of differences between different application systems, reportings, and how funds were being distributed. But I have to say that the our engagement with the Scottish Government was fantastic during the pandemic in terms of funding. So, you know, we have to focus on the things that maybe could have been improved for the future, but at the same time, we need to recognise that I think it was an overall positive experience.
Many thanks, Paul. Before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, I can see that Kia Shahinska is looking to come back in.
Well, I would like to echo all of the points that that Duncan and Paul have mentioned. But I think in terms of, especially around the flexibility of different funders, both some of the government's funds, but also the independent funders. But also I would like to ask on the, I would like to add in terms of the trust that Paul has mentioned in terms of the intermediary bodies. I think that trust has actually extended to the third sector organisations. And I think that in some cases, not in all cases, but in some cases that changed the relationship between the funder and the funded organisations. And I think that's something really important where the funded organisations trusted to do and what they believe is best for their community and for the people that they support. And I think this is something that we would like to bring into the future. I think from positives as well, some of the initiatives included routes and platforms for local intelligence to be fed through the funding processes. And I think this is also something that we would like to bring into the future.
Thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I'm really pleased to hear that those things that were put in place were positive, and I hope that they will continue because it does show that we can do things differently and be very fleet of foot when we need to. So it's really encouraging to hear that. The question I have is specifically around the Resilience Fund and the local authorities who were able to access that, and then of course the additional 10 that were able to access it. And probably for Kaya, if that's okay, are you aware of how they were chosen? Do you think that they went to the areas where it was needed the most? And when the additional 10 were added, did that come with additional funding, or was it a case of kind of spreading the initial funding slightly differently?
In terms of the Resilience Fund?
Yeah, the Community Recovery Fund, sorry.
Community Recovery Fund. I mean, we haven't, the TSI network hasn't been involved, so I'm not really aware of why some of the choices have been made.
Okay, is anyone else on the panel?
Bradley's looking to come in. Paul Bradley's looking to come in here.
People always call me Bradley. So I don't have a very clear answer for you here, unfortunately. But what I would say is SCBO provided the platform for distributing the funds and for the assessment across many different funds, and that included the Community Recovery Fund. But what was different about the Community Recovery Fund is that we didn't have any involvement in setting up the kind of terms of how that fund would be managed or how it should be allocated. So in that respect, we're not clear on how those decisions were made. But I wanted to be clear that obviously there is some form of SCBO involvement in that, in terms of the shared funding platform that we developed and built with partners, and we then used that with, we allowed Scottish Government to use that and use that resource for different funds. But I think there's that point about, I just said about what didn't work so well, and I think maybe there's potential for lack of transparency around how some of these different funds were put together. Obviously, they're put together at speed, and I'm sure there are absolutely kind of valid reasons for why certain groups are picked over others. I'm sure those could be explained by government, but I think that transparency, it raises questions, and two key kind of organisations or groups in the sector aren't able to answer that.
Thank you.
Okay, Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. And again, as colleagues have said, thank you to your organisations for everything you did during the pandemic and going forward. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to TSIs, third sector interfaces, and just specifically with regards to the funding of those. Now, they have an annual budget of £26 million. So I wanted to ask, how do you see that utilised? Do you think it's sufficient? And what would your ask be around that, especially given we have the budget today? So I'll maybe start with Keir and then go around.
Thank you. So the TSI budget has been at a standstill since inception about 10 years ago. And we haven't had inflationary increases. One of the TSI partners has done a calculation, and obviously there has been a decrease in capacity, but the decrease in funding equals to 37% since the day of their inception. So this is quite a significant decrease in capacity as well. I also think probably it's worth mentioning that with the TSI role evolving as a result of the review in 2018, many more pressures have been placed on TSIs, with the role being more strategic. And the considering widespread spectrum of areas that TSIs get involved at a local level, sometimes they really have to make hard choices in what they can get involved in due to their capacity. And I think especially on the community planning level, in some areas, there's some investment from the community planning towards capacity within TSIs, but that is a different picture across the country. And what that means is that the TSIs are not always, sometimes they have to make impossible choices in terms of getting involved and supporting the voice of the third sector within those priorities that are identified locally. Probably worth mentioning are the pressures which the TSIs have experienced similarly as the rest of the sector. And in our report earlier this year, in our internal report, a lot of chief officers have named the challenge of capacity and increasing workloads on themselves and staff. And this is mainly due to, partially due to the pandemic and the demands from the organizations themselves. It's due to the fact that the profile of the sector has risen during the pandemic, which is a very positive thing, but then that also places expectations on TSIs from different public partners to get involved in various agendas. I think what is probably also worth mentioning is that we really have worked with the third sector unit, and we appreciate and recognize the support they have provided for us, especially over the past year. And we welcome the involvement in the Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund, in the Adult Learning Fund, and the ability to support directly the third sector organisations that we serve, especially in terms of the grassroots third sector organisations with those funds. We also welcome the fact that the review of the funding formula is mentioned in the Programme for Government for this year. So overall, there are many positive steps that have been taken in terms of ensuring that capacity of TSIs is adequate to the work that they're doing. But at the same time, I think it's important to remember that we have seen this decrease in capacity over the past 10 years.
Thank you. Was there anyone else who wanted to come in?
Yes, I can see Paul Bradley and Martin Tyson are both looking to come in here.
Yes, I think SCVO probably wouldn't comment directly on the specific levels of funding for our local partners. And I think it's important that the committee listens to the experts in this, which are the TSIs themselves. I would point out, I think that and I could be wrong here, but I think the 26 million figure that's in the briefing isn't just for TSIs, but it is for a whole range of infrastructure bodies, which includes SCVO. So I want to be clear there that SCVO is a recipient of this fund too. And obviously I'm here to talk about the kind of wider sector. But I would talk about the infrastructure of the sector as a whole and the importance of investment in that, which stretches not only to the TSIs and well beyond SCVO, but to 60 plus national intermediaries that work in kind of thematic areas like health and community and social care and so on. And as I say, I think that the pandemic has highlighted the importance of having that fostered and in place to mobilise groups and get resources to where it's needed. And be interesting to, we wouldn't ever know, but how would we have supported all these people and organisations over the course of the past 18 months without that solid infrastructure in place? But as Kaya said, that has been chipped away over recent years. And I think that on that point about budgets being at a standstill, it's crucial that intermediary organisations, infrastructure organisations, do receive long-term funding, just like other organisations in the sector, but they also do get inflationary uplifts. It's absolutely crucial. And also that these intermediaries are funded based on the needs of their areas too, rather than just things being dished out without any thought about what the actual need is. And therefore, maybe there's not enough resources that these organisations are getting to actually manage that increasing need. So I think it's absolutely vital that infrastructure is supported and funded. And as we've heard, I think over the past 3 years, that budget's gone from about 24.5 million to 26 million. But within that, many of the kind of budget lines would have been standstill. And I'm not clear on what that increase went towards.
Thanks, Paul. Martin Tyson, please.
Thanks. Yeah, I really want to echo the point about the importance of the TSIs, but also the general sort of landscape of intermediary bodies. But the point for us is that the Scottish charity sector is very much biased towards smaller charities. That most charities in Scotland are volunteer run. They're very small in terms of income. So the support that they get from intermediary bodies is really key. It's also a very dynamic sector. There's a lot of every year that there's a lot of charities being deregistered and a lot of new charities being registered again. There's a need for the support and the infrastructure to be there. So that is a key function as far as we're concerned. They're key partners.
Thank you for that. I was interested, it was raised by yourself, Keir, with regards to community capacity building. And one of the things which I know from my own region, going around different organisations, is during the pandemic, a lot of that was organic. A lot of the work which was undertaken previously, I think, would have been more risk averse. People wouldn't have been brought in. But actually, that public health emergency response saw a lot of organisations adapt and really build that. So I suppose my question is, in terms of TSIs and other organisations, organisations. How do we make sure that that volunteer capacity and those who have wanted to support their communities over the last 20 months isn't lost going forward, and what's been learnt during the pandemic to really make sure that potential barriers we've seen previously to volunteering are removed?
So probably a good example in terms of how this capacity can be harnessed is Eastern Bartonshire TSI and how they have harnessed some of the capacity of the volunteers that have came through the Reach Scotland campaign, but also throughout the pandemic. So what has happened with Eastern Bartonshire was that mutual aid groups sprung up at the start of the pandemic when they were most needed in different areas of Eastern Bartonshire. Through the Reach Scotland campaign, Eastern Bartonshire TSI has directed the volunteers to the most appropriate geographical area for them, and also according to their interests. But what is quite interesting about the model and the approach they have taken is that they have supported the groups throughout. So as the volunteers were maybe moving on to something else, and they have supported them with further volunteer recruitment to those mutual groups. But they have also supported them with governance. They helped them constitute, they helped them access further funding, and then for this way they build further capacity for those groups and for the sector. And I think this holistic approach is something we need to take when we think about volunteer recruitment, but also when we think about, I think, any aspect of the third sector and TSIs. This is what TSIs are really trying to do. In terms of harnessing the volunteering in the recovery phase, I would say that is volunteer management is crucial in making sure that volunteers are supported. And I think volunteering needs to be recognized and volunteering needs to be supported, and I think that what makes it thrive. So I'll probably just echo the point I made before that volunteer management is always crucial, and volunteers can't really, it can happen on its own. There needs to be support provided for it.
Thank you very much indeed. Paul Bradley's wanting to come in briefly here, please.
Sorry, my microphone wasn't unmuted. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes.
Yes, sorry about that. I just wanted to draw the committee's attention to the volunteering action plan that's currently being developed. Stakeholders are working together over the next 6 or 7 months to look at many of the barriers that organisations face. I'm not sure if that was mentioned just then because I got logged out. But I think also to draw the committee's attention to the Scottish Volunteering Forum, as well as a really great resource and a group of organisations that would be well worth speaking to if the committee was going to be looking at this in a little bit more detail going forward, in addition to SCVO and others.
Thank you very much indeed. Next question from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener. The first question I have is for Kaya. In your submission to the committee, you note that in order to achieve the Volunteering for All strategy and to get to a fairer Scotland, a number of social security changes and other changes would need to happen. Can you tell us a bit about what those specific social security changes would need to be so that we can support volunteering and encourage it?
I would probably echo Paul's point that it is the volunteering framework and volunteering action plan has adopted a really good approach looking at those different changes. And I know that as we speak, they're looking at things like barriers to volunteering in terms of different protected groups and protected characteristics. And I think in many ways, there's a lot of exploration that still needs to be done to understand some of these barriers. And I think this is one of the things that has been acknowledged within this work that has been happening at the moment. Because of course, those barriers to volunteering, they will be very different for the very for all of the different protected characteristics. So I think probably the first thing is, well, the main thing I would say is the approach that has been taken with to address those issues is really good from the TSI point of view. And also bringing together different stakeholders and looking very holistically at the volunteering picture. But also I think there needs to be a bit more work done in understanding those barriers, because I think probably we don't have a full understanding yet.
Can you talk specifically about any barriers within social security?
Within social security, I would probably say so. I know there is work being done. You know, there is work being done across the network and within that action plan around people being able to volunteer while they're on benefits. And I think there have been some barriers in accessing volunteering in those cases. Probably, you know, I can come back to you with specifics around this. I'm probably I'll probably need to contact people who are best placed to speak about this from the network.
Thank you. That's really helpful. My final question is for, if that's okay, for Paul and Martin, and it's around the sustained funding. And given that there's a 3-year funding approach now from the UK government, have you any indication that kind of approach will be transferred to the funding arrangements that you'll get through from the Scottish government?
I'm happy to go first. No real indication other than what's been said in recent years about there being a shift to an approach to multi-year funding. And I think this multi-year is important because, you know, yes, 3-year funding would be great, but maybe even longer is needed. I've been in committee sessions where I've spoken a fair bit about multi-year funding and the response that comes is about a specific fund within government around equalities and human rights, but these are small funding streams within the grand scheme of things. And actually, you know, the hundreds of millions of pounds that goes towards the voluntary sector to support it to deliver vital services in communities, you know, that aspect is just a small part, and we need to see this rolled out across all parts of government. And I'm hearing already recently organisations that have had multi-year funding are now going down to single-year funding. So we're trying to do a little bit more work on this to see where this is happening, where there's good practice and where there's less so good practice. But I think we saw in the Public Audit Committee meeting last week, Audit Scotland say that we have to move away from single-year funding if we want to deliver on outcomes. And I mean, you know, we talk a lot about the Christie Commission, which is over 10 years ago. You know, if you want to deliver long-term change, then you have to fund for the long term. And everyone around this table, I know, knows that. And I'm sure if I was sitting there, I could see your head shaking. But we understand the challenges, but we need to find solutions. And as you say, things like the UK government with its spending plan, multi-year, and the Scottish government looking at how it funds voluntary organisations for that longer term. And I understand that the uncertainty of you know, voluntary organisations are sensible. We know that, yes, things can change. But even having that kind of indicative sense that you were going to get renewed funding, and not just renewed funding, but inflationary uplift as well, year on year, is really important. So I'm more than happy to continue to communicate with the committee over the next months and years in terms of SCVO's work in this area, because we are doing a lot to really understand where multi-year funding is happening, where it's really happening, and not just you know, the kind of rolling single-year funding that isn't increasing. But we have to see progress in this area. For so many different reasons, whether it's about job security, whether it's about the outcomes that we want to deliver as a sector and as a country, and unfortunately, it's slow where progress is being made.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. With 10 minutes left, looking for brief questions and answers, please. Martin, are you looking to come in at this stage?
I mean, as far as OSCA's funding goes, we're aligning the Scottish budget, and we will find out about that along with everyone else. But in terms of the sector funding, I very much echo the point that sustainable funding and flexible funding is needed for sector bodies, both from Scottish Government and from other funders. That point I made earlier about being able to build up reserves is a key one. It's, you know, there's been a lot of praise for the resilience of the sector and the flexibility of the sector, but, you know, to be able to just avoid flying by the seat of the pants and build up the resilience, the diversity in terms of funding streams, and the ability to cope with you know, headwinds like the pandemic, multi-year funding is I think flexibility in approach to funding is really vital.
Thank you very much indeed, Martin. Next set of questions from Brevity Personified. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. And again, just add my thanks for all the work that you've done, and as someone who's worked in the third sector, for the pressure that a lot of you are under. I wonder if I can start my question to Paul. Just going back to last year and the funding that came from Scottish Government and from the UK Government. I got quite a lot of feedback over the last summer that a lot of the money went to the big charities, you know, your kind of headline charities, who I will not name, while a lot of the small charities who were doing the work on the ground really struggled to get that money. Is that just whinging from the small charities, or was there any truth behind that? And how do we learn going forward how we can get the money to the people who are actually doing the work rather than who might shout loudest?
I mean, it's absolutely not whinging at all. And I think every organisation faces unique experiences in their funding situation. And, you know, I was speaking to an organisation just recently that's put in 100 applications this year for funding and has received nothing. Just because their area of work isn't necessarily kind of a Scottish Government or, you know, a national priority as such. But still really important. So those are just long-term issues. In terms of the funding that went to voluntary organisations, I think that, of course, there's lots to learn, and we would hope that would come through in evaluations, and more than happy to kind of speak to our team on that and get back in touch with the committee with any information that we have in terms of the breakdown, which we will have in terms of size and scale of organisation and location. But I think that, I mean, initially the there were small sums of money that were put out through the wellbeing funds to get to people who are most in need. You know, that funding was kind of small, in the kind of couple of thousands. That was actually, it wasn't through open applications, but it was through existing networks where due diligence on those organisations has already been done. So we knew we could trust those organisations. They had the robust you know, governance in place to be able to handle that kind of money and get it to where it was needed most. But there was also open applications, and all of that information, especially the SCVO managed funds on behalf of government, all of that information on who got funds and for what is on our website. But I will get in touch with the committee to follow up on that particular point. But of course, there are always going to be organisations that have missed out. And I think particularly, you know, some of the funds, for example, you know, issues around if you've got too much reserves, then do you necessarily qualify for certain levels of resilience funding? But then if you use all your reserves up and then later down the line you too late to get resilience funding, then you're worse off. So that, I think that there's obviously loads of things that we can learn from the specifics of how funds are developed and how we can improve that for small and large organisations which have unique challenges. And I think what's important is we don't pit small and large organisations against each other.
Thank you. I think that is one of the interesting issues about reserves and how we hold reserves. If I can just move us on to one other theme quickly, and that is in regard to future reform of how charities are regulated. Obviously, we've got Martin here. There is, I think, the government have announced there will be legislation coming forward in this session to reform OSCA and the practices of it. I suppose my question is, someone who is a trustee of lots of small charities, it does seem to be heavy on paperwork. And I wonder, from your position, Martin, are you conscious that the small charities often have to fill in the same number of information as the large charities, and how do we get around that? I mean, maybe Paul and others, from your perspective as a charity, what reforms would you like to see? Are you talking, Martin?
Sorry, I'm. I wasn't sure whether my microphone is live there.
It
can
is.
You hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Yes, thank you. I don't think it is true that smaller charities are asked to provide the same level of paperwork as larger ones. That there is a sort of graduated regime there. Most small charities will, for instance, generate much simpler accounts than the larger charities. Also, we ask smaller charities for much less information in their annual return every year, and we, you know, that's something we really keep under review. It's something we have changed and slimmed down over the year. I think one of the other things is a sort of learning point for us through the pandemic. We took a more relaxed approach to enforcing some of the compliance regime. We also took a different approach to some of the documentation that we looked at. And one of the things that we're doing at the moment is to see whether some of the sort of innovations that came in and some of the streamlining that we did during the pandemic, how far we can take that forward. In terms of the reforms to the Act, obviously, we have to the charity legislation. That's something that we have called for. We put various proposals to Scottish ministers, and we'll look forward to working with their Scottish ministers on those.
Final question, just back to David. David, as we come out of this, or hopefully at some point come out of this pandemic, and as we move forward, do you think there'll be a lot of smaller charities, medium-sized charities that will start merging? Do you think we'll see a redefining of the sector because of what's happened in the last 2 years? Or do you think in a few years' time it will just look fairly similar? Paul, yeah, please.
Is that for myself?
Yes, please.
I think, yes, we've seen organisations merge and worked really well, and other mergers that haven't worked so well. I think if there is a case-by-case basis where organisations feel that they can deliver better outcomes and do better for people, then absolutely. But I don't think that we should be kind of saying there's lots of organisations working in this area, so therefore, we should be merging. Lots of them will have different specialist skills and provide, that's the unique aspect of the voluntary sector is that specialism that's there. Can I just quickly touch on that charity law point? Because I think it's really, really important, because a lot of what we talk about resilience is about operational and financial, but we kind of often forget the reputational resilience of the sector. And absolutely, the voluntary sector, as we've seen through all of the years that have gone by in recent times, that we have a shared reputation that we share amongst all charities and voluntary organisations. If something happens to one organisation, the cloud forms over all of us. And it's really important that we have robust regulations and legislation in place that supports voluntary organisations, charities in this case, to do their very best. And I think in terms of the public trust in charities, it's great to see Oscar's report recently that public trust is at its highest level in Scotland in charities that we've seen since records began in 2009. But we can't take that for granted. And absolutely, the changes that are being proposed by Oscar and Scottish Government, with tweaks and with more involvement of the sector in terms of shaping those through the legislative process, is vital that Oscar gets the powers it needs to be able to perform its role as a regulator. I would like to say one final point, though, is that I think the sector has not been asked what reforms we would like to see to modern charity law, and that the Act hasn't been updated since 2005. Proposals put on the table are very much proposals, and rightly so, put forward by Oscar and Scottish Government on how to strengthen the regulator's role, and that's really important. But we have not been asked what changes we need to see as charities. And let's not forget that the legislation around charity law, I should say we have been consulted on those proposals that have been put forward, but we haven't been asked about what changes we would like to see as charities. And that's important, because at the end of the day, this factors into the reputation of charities themselves, not just the reputation of having a strong regulator, but charities themselves. And it's not SCVO's role to say what should change within charity law, but I think voluntary organisations need, charities need need the opportunity to say what they want to see change to ensure their credibility, legitimacy and reputation going forward. And I'd like to say that if proposals to charity law are implemented over the next year or so, that cannot shut the door to further discussions for another 16 years on changes to charity law that charities might want to see to make that more robust for charities themselves.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed, Paul. Final set of questions in this panel from Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thank you, convener, and hello to the panel, and thanks for all your contributions so far. They've been very helpful. How can we make sure there is partnership and cooperation in the third sector if organisations are constantly competing against each other for funding and contracts? Is there a more holistic way that we can do this? And could I put that to Paul Bradley, please?
Yes, of course. So, as I said, SCVO are currently sponsoring a Scottish First Sector Research Tracker, which is a kind of community of 600 organisations. And the next wave of those results in early 2022 will go into some detail about partnership work in longer term and what's changed since the emergency funding has kind of dried up and so on. But I think overall, voluntary organisations really are keen to work in a collaborative manner, and we've seen that during the course of the pandemic, and we've seen that from local authorities, from national government and so on. But I think really it's the funding structures, the funding systems that are in place that really hold all of that back. From a kind of a small level, if you've got application processes for grants where even in the pandemic government was encouraging organisations to work in partnership, but we're giving them a 6-week window to get their application in, which just isn't long enough to form new partnerships and trust and all those kind of things. So that needs to be improved. Obviously, the big one is procurement. We've seen a shift. Every single conversation we have really with voluntary organisations in procurement is about that shift to procurement over the past 10 or so years, in favour of cost cutting. And arrangements tend to be unfavourable, but also as the around fair work and no inflation and so on. But I think the point you're making about the competition aspect there and making voluntary organisations compete with one another and drive down the quality of services, because maybe what's being bid for is not at the right level of costs and. Also, it kind of freezes out smaller, more specialised organisations who we might want to see involved in the kind of procurement landscape. But I have to say, it's not just procurement; it is funding overall. And the Equalities and Human Rights Committee back in 2019 heard about how qualities groups are pitted against each other to secure funding. And I think within that report on value in the third sector, the Scottish Government was asked to work with statutory partners. And the voluntary sector to look at how partnership working could be improved and what its plan was for that. And I'm yet to see any progress that's been made in terms of that recommendation.
Final question, Evelyn.
Yes, thanks, convener. How can we ensure that the third sector are at the heart of social and economic recovery? What can local authorities, UK and Scottish governments do to ensure that this happens? And could I put that to Duncan Thorpe, please?
Hi there, apologies everybody. My broadband literally just went down completely during the session, which hasn't happened in the past 18 months, bizarrely. Could I ask you just to repeat that question if that's okay?
Yes, no problem. How can we ensure that the third sector are at the heart of social and economic recovery? What can local authorities, UK and Scottish governments do to ensure that this happens?
I think some of it's about mainstreaming, to be honest. I think if you deal with a certain department within the local authority within the Scottish Government, as a charity or a social enterprise, you can get kind of contracts, you can get funding kind of thing, but I think often it's a case of other departments within local authorities and government don't understand social enterprise in the third sector. And I think there's a real issue here with just really mainstreaming the sector and really just kind of breaking out of our kind of bubble in a sense. So I think that If you speak to certain economic development officers within local authorities, they understand social enterprise, they deal with social enterprise on a daily basis. But if you speak to perhaps certain procurement officers or other departments within a local authority, there's just not that understanding. And I think it's that kind of trying to kind of break out of the kind of the usual suspects in a sense, and just really trying to speak to other officials, speak to other kind of departments, just to really get them to understand. And I think sometimes it is just kind of a basic awareness raising to start with. I think there's just a bit of a misunderstanding about what charities and social enterprises do and how they contribute to our economies at a local level.
Thank you very much indeed, Duncan. I can see that Martin and Paul are looking to come back in there. I'm very sorry to say our time for that part of our session is up. I'd be delighted if there is anything that any of our panel this morning feel they haven't been able to get across for us to take that in writing, if you're willing to do that. I'm very grateful to you all for your time and insight this morning. It's very helpful to us in terms of our work, and we greatly appreciate it. So thank you very much indeed. I would like to suspend the meeting for 2 minutes now in order to change over witnesses. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed, and welcome back. Thank you again to witnesses from panel one. Very grateful to colleagues who have joined us in panel two. We have Ian Bruce, Chief Executive of Glasgow Council for the Voluntary Sector, Ian McNeill, Chief Officer of the Voluntary Action Barra and Battersea, Partner in Sector Interface Western Isles, Glenn Liddle, Chief Executive People Know How, Susie Burt, Trustee of Letham for All, and Miles Fitt, the Strategic Associate Lead of Financial Health at Citizens Advice Scotland. Very grateful to you all for joining us this morning. First question from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please. And again, if I could remind colleagues to direct who their questions would be for. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks again for the submissions that you've already sent in and for joining us. And I'd like to again put on record my thanks to the work that you've done. My thanks to you for the work that you've all done ongoing, but also particularly in this past year and a half, which I know has been a really, really difficult time for the sector. So I just want to say thank you. I appreciate the work that you do. My first question is for Miles, if that's okay, at Citizens Advice Scotland. A couple of questions. The first is that in your latest data, you've noted 138% increase in visits to your mental health pages. Could you tell us a little bit about why you might think that is on the basis of perhaps what you're hearing through your bureaus? And also, could you tell us a bit about the model that's been used through delivering services online or on the phone, and the importance of a kind of hybrid approach, if indeed that's what you're hoping to do going forward? Thanks.
Okay. Thanks for the questions. In terms of mental health, yes, there is an increase in the people coming with mental health issues. I'll take this maybe from a financial health perspective, which is the area that I work in. It's maybe a good way to do this. People who are obviously struggling with debt and mental health and money is interlinked. So there's people who have money problems that cause mental health, and you have mental health that is exacerbated by money worries. And of course, through the pandemic, there's been a whole set of concerns about people's finances and well-being and where they're managing to pay bills and just all the ups and downs of their financial lives. So that has led to an increase in people who are coming with mental health concerns. And that is an area of focus for the CAB service and for Citizens Advice Scotland going forward. In terms of the delivery of advice and how we do this, we absolutely embrace a multi-channel approach for anyone seeking advice. So not just face-to-face, but we do have, you know, whether it's email, it's web chat, it's phone advice, and also through our online pages. So we at the height of the pandemic at the start, we were seeing a lot of traffic, a significant number of traffic coming in to our online site, whereby people are looking for employment and benefits, understandably, because that's where the concerns were, but also about paying bills and budgeting. It wasn't necessarily about debt as such, it was actually about money. How do they pay the bills? How do they manage their money? So that there's a whole set of ways in which people have been engaging with the service going forward. And I would just say there is a concern that we would want to make sure that whilst the pandemic has necessitated a multi-channel approach, and we absolutely fully endorse that people should have all the options open to them, we would want to make sure that the face-to-face element, which is incredibly important to be able to give certainly vulnerable people the opportunity to have that human contact on a face-to-face level, doesn't get left behind. So that's something we're very keen to make sure that going forward, that face-to-face remains an integral part of how we deliver our services, and that digital doesn't become the default necessarily, but it, as I say, it should be part of a range of options.
Thank you for that. And my next question, if that's okay, briefly to Ian, is that could you tell us a little bit about the experience of your organisation in terms of being able to deliver for the people you represent and the organisations that you represent, and specifically around the employment of the people in your organisations? And have you seen any need across the city for redundancies? And has that been an ongoing concern in the last year and a half?
Absolutely. Happy to answer that. We haven't seen, for a range of reasons, we haven't seen the levels at different points in the pandemic. So we had obviously expected it early on that the UK government furlough scheme mitigated some of that early on. We also saw the additional investment from Scottish Government, which enabled many organisations that might have had to make tougher decisions to pivot their organisations and think about how they responded in a different way. So up to now, we haven't seen huge numbers of redundancies. However, we are now starting to see some organisations struggling, particularly as they start to look forward to the next financial year. So the investments that have been made during the last 18 months have to an extent mitigated some of the things, but what we now have for many of our members is a lack of clarity around what is next, what funding will they have next year. And a number of our members are telling us that they're distinctly sitting at the moment with deficit budgets for next year, and that is going to result almost certainly in conversations around redundancy. And for me, that sits at the heart of the capacity of the sector to be a fair work employer, a fair work sector. You know, that context of organisations that many people in the third sector are often on time limited contracts, and a proportion, not the overwhelming majority, but certainly a significant proportion of third sector organisations find themselves repeatedly having to go through the motions of redundancy, the putting people at risk of redundancy, even if they're then able to withdraw that because they don't have the reserves and they don't have the income security to be able to avoid doing so. So it is a challenge.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Next question from Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you very much for given the evidence this morning. It's really helpful to us, very much appreciated. There's a lot of joint working between third sector and councils. How important do you see the third sector relationship with local government, and what can be done to improve it? Any examples you could give of good practice during COVID that you'd like to highlight this morning? I'll put that to Miles and Ian, actually. Thanks.
Okay. Over the course of the pandemic, I mean, local authorities were really, really great in terms of applying forbearance when it came to issues around paying council tax and other payments that you have to make to local authorities. There was a great flexibility from local authorities, and that's something we would certainly want to see going forward. And there is a strong link between the cab service and local authority services as well. I think the pandemic showed that there was strong working together on various areas, and we would like to see, you know, everyone talks about the new normal and how we progress going forward, and we'd like to see that continue, and we certainly will endeavour to do so.
Thank you very much indeed, Miles. Ian, please.
Yeah, absolutely. Some great examples during COVID. A sense for me that the rule book got thrown out the door in favour of relationships and trust, and I think that was really, really powerful. And certainly in the city, what we saw was organisations coming together. We worked with our local authority around the development of the Glasgow Helps framework, which was about understanding in the city which organisations were best placed to help people and marry that up. I think what's concerning for me is that we are not out of this pandemic yet, and already the system is starting to creep back in. So we've seen really welcome, for example, we've seen really welcome financial interventions from Scottish Government in areas like employability and children's mental health coming into the city, resources that are there to be, you know, to be used to support people during challenging times, in which I think everyone would expect the third sector to play a significant part in. But actually we've had real barriers around procurement in particular, or commissioning more broadly, and how that money can flow from local authority coffers into third sector organisations that are best placed to deliver. And that process is slow when actually the response requires to be fast. And in particular during this year, we've seen a number of interventions from Scottish Government that are money that require to be spent in year, and actually local authority are simply in a position that they're saying we simply cannot commission, get that money out of the door in a timeline, legally in a timeline that would enable any organisation to deliver anything meaningful within the year. And that's a real concern, because that's the sort of red tape that we were able to put aside during COVID, and which now is very much back in force.
What do you think can be done to improve? Just back to you, Ian.
Yeah, I suspected that was coming back to me. I mean, I think we need to have a real think about what commissioning and procurement looks like. There are two things here. I really welcome the Auditor General's comments the other day about you know, people not feeling that they're going to be scrutinised for taking, you know, I don't want to misquote him, but the concept of people being freer to take chances. And I think there is some capacity within the current rules for people to be a little bit more relaxed, but I do think that probably what is needed is something which transforms the rules. I think there are, particularly when you look at what third sector organisations do, a lot of the value of what third sector organisations do comes from the relationship that those organisations have with the communities and the people they support. And I don't think our current procurement approach recognises that. And a lot of the procurement that we do treats the commissioning of those sorts of services not hugely differently from the procurement of IT support or pencils for schools.
I can see that Glenn Liddle is looking to come in here as well. Please, Glenn.
Thank you very much. Thanks to the committee for being invited along this morning. I just wanted to come back and respond in terms of how the third sector and the public sector works together. Forgive me, I've not been at one of these committees before. Possibly I'm kind of wide of the mark, but a lot of the things I've heard this morning seem to be quite absolute. It's this way or it's that way. And I think a lot of the work in the sector is far more nuanced. There are good examples, for example, of where third sector, public sector have worked together. Yes, of course there are. But there also are still lots of barriers. And these go back to times way, way before the pandemic. We still have a situation where people work in silos. And that happens within local authorities. That happens within public sector. I experience that on a regular basis, where to try and get two different parts of the system to work together, it's just a real struggle. So that was the first point I wanted to make, was around silo working. That still very much exists. There's also, I think, a tendency to operate in a manner which is around addressing things in a first aid approach. So what I mean by that is that people look at the kind of the immediate response, the emergency response. What can we do to patch things up? And people don't, I think this is the people struggle to look at those more structural and systematic changes that need to happen to actually do things differently. There are a lot of things that still happen that are being created by the system. If we change the system, we could actually not have to address some things that happen. The third point I wanted to make was around the power dynamic. And again, we've heard really good examples this morning of how everyone's working together and is valued, and there's truth in that, but there's also a real issue around parity of esteem. If I'm sure you'll all be aware of the kind of hustings, all political parties spoke about this in terms of there should be parity of esteem between public sector and third sector, and it simply isn't there. A lot of that, I think, is around the a lot of the language this morning, again, is very absolute, is very cognitive, is very what do we need to do? And I think a lot of what needs to happen is actually to get a greater understanding of the third sector. I think there needs to be a shift and a change in culture and in values, and just in really how we look at those relationships going forward. The other thing that I think is missing from this morning is that people know how we talk a lot about Connect Four, and that's the bringing together of the public sector, the third sector, the business world, and academia. And that is a really powerful combination when we can get those people into those spaces working together. And again, we've got really, really good examples of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. I can also see Ian McNeill and Miles Fitt are looking to come back in, come in here as well. Ian, please.
Thank you, Convener. I was just thinking there's something around the community empowerment agenda that comes down from the Scottish Government and goes through local authorities and then makes its way through to our communities, and their communities kind of look at it and think, right, what is this? And it's like, well, we're going to give you some more powers. Along comes a pandemic and all of a sudden there's a rush on to put the onus on communities to try and sort out local affairs, what's happening there. And here's, by the way, here's some money to support that. And so looking back on that, I think it's probably worthwhile to look and see how communities reacted to that and how well they reacted to that challenge of having some resources put to them in a very short space of time and trying to target them.
Thank you very much indeed. Miles Fitt, please.
Yeah, I just like to take this opportunity to make the point around, you know, voluntary organisations, I'm speaking from a CAB perspective, that, you know, being seen as you know, essential community assets. You know, the CAB service is a very important service, but there's an element whereby it's an essential community asset. You know, CABs are anchored in local communities, and, you know, they deliver a service that's best suited to local needs. They have that local connection between advisors and between local people, and that's extremely important. And also there's the opportunity for people who are volunteers to go on to other jobs and get into employment. So I think it's important going forward that the recognition that the third sector isn't just about necessarily service delivery, but it's the valuable role in which they play within that. You know, there's an agenda, the community wealth agenda, and across Scotland, organisations are more than just service providers in many ways. They're actual assets to the community, and I think that should be recognised by the committee and by you know, public sector and by the Scottish Government as well.
Thank you very much, Steve. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for your responses so far. They've been really helpful. In terms of support during the pandemic, could you tell us a little bit about the funding that went for the recovery fund to specific local authorities? And are you aware of the way that money was delivered and distributed? What were the criteria? And when the additional local authorities were added to that criteria, that funding rather, do you know if additional funding followed that, or was the original source spread across? And maybe if we could hear from Ian Bruce and Ian McNeill on that. Thanks.
Thank you. Obviously, Glasgow was not included in the original 10 local authorities, which was obviously a surprise to us, considering the challenges that we know exist in the city. And obviously further concerned that the further 10 local authorities also didn't include Glasgow. So that's really all I can say to that question. To be honest, we haven't had any further involvement in it other than concern that Glasgow was not included.
Thank you.
And Ian McNeill, please.
And so in terms of the funding that we got in the Western Isles, it was obviously targeted. I suppose if any comment I had to make is the lag in the administration time in terms of understanding what the fund was about and then putting in an application and then waiting for approval. And so I think when you have organisations that run funding to go out to communities, they have to consider the amount of administration that's involved in that for TSIs and local partners, and the time it takes to put it out, and then you follow normal. They tend to follow normal audit streams, whereas maybe in terms of the time lag that it's taking to identify what the need is to actually getting the fund to them, by the time that maybe 4 months has passed. And therefore, the need is maybe not as great.
Thank you. I have one additional question on this, if that's okay. That's really helpful. We heard earlier about some of the disadvantages that people experience in terms of volunteering, and the numbers of specifically of disabled people who've been volunteering are of a concern. Do either of the panel members this morning have anything that they could tell us a bit about that, those figures, and also if you've got any experience that you can share about improving volunteering or supporting disabled people to volunteer and how we could try and make that happen across the country? I didn't want to pick on someone, just in case, but if there's any... I know, Ian, forgive me, in Glasgow, there's Glasgow Disability Alliance have been quite involved in a lot of work, but is there anything that you could share that we could try and listen to and look to improve elsewhere?
I think I'm going to speak because you've come to me, but just for people to be aware that the Third Sector Interface in Glasgow is a partnership TSI, and so volunteering isn't our area of focus. But I think from my experience, what I would say is part of the challenge over the last 18 months that we've heard from organisations is that organisations are telling us that bringing on board new volunteers during the pandemic is particularly challenging, and that's been an area of difficulty. I think there is, and I was listening into panel one, and I did hear some input around the recognition that volunteering is not a free activity, and there is something here about how we make sure that third sector organisations are resourced in a way that enables them to think about how volunteering is effectively included. There is a wider agenda as well, which is about, I think, how we improve equalities practice within the third sector. The third sector is obviously a really important part of society in Scotland, but contributes hugely. But we have to be honest and recognise that the sector won't always have as good equalities practice as we would like. And I think that's an area of focus for us as intermediary organisations in the future. For our sector to make sure we're always being inclusive, and we're always at the forefront of making sure that everyone is able to participate in our sector.
Thank you very much indeed. I can see that Miles Fitt and Glenn Little are looking to come back in, and I'm also conscious that we haven't heard from Susie Burt as yet. Susie, if you have anything that you'd like to add, if you could please type R into the chat function in Blue Jeans, please. Miles Fitt, please.
Yeah, it was just to quickly say that what I echo Ian's point about, we've had an increase in volunteers wanting to come and get involved with the cab service, but the challenge of the pandemic has been difficult to be able to respond to, give them the training that they have needed. So that's been difficult. On the point about from those who are disabled, I'm happy to, it's not something I can answer just now, but I'm happy to contact the committee later and yourself, Pam, with an answer, if that's okay.
Thank you. That'd be helpful. Thanks.
Glenn.
Thank you. I really thought we should respond. People know how we talk a lot about VIPs, volunteers, interns and placement students. In the last 12 months, we've had about 250 such people supporting us, along with a staff team of about 20 or so. So for us, they are essential. We simply couldn't do all the things that we do, and they hold a whole range of responsibilities. I think it's also worth pointing out, again, this is obvious, but our board of trustees, as with every charity, are also volunteers, and they bring a huge amount of experience, talent and time to the organisation. In terms of specifically to support people around disabilities, we have always taken the approach of being very open to everybody. And wherever possible, we'll make adjustments, we'll support people. We have a number of people that do volunteer with us on a regular basis that have a whole range of disabilities. I think it's also worth acknowledging that there are a lot of disabilities that are quite hidden and are not so obvious. And it's not until you really get to know somebody and unpack that, we find out what their needs are and how to best support them. We, as an organisation, went through the process to gain our Invest in Volunteers accreditation. That's been very, very important to us. Being open to challenge. Yeah, we haven't got it right. I think the whole sector needs to be constantly looking at how our practice and how we do that in the best possible way. Another point, not directly related to supporting people with disabilities, but supported to the voluntary sector, to supporting volunteers. We have a volunteer officer. We're actually looking to recruit a volunteer coordinator. And there's been a lot of comment about how volunteers require lots of support, and that's absolutely right and true. But it's also not an absolute. There are many organisations that function purely on volunteers. Their board are volunteers. They're the people that operate on the ground are volunteers as well. And those operations, those organisations can work very, very adequately. I'm on the board of one such organisation just now, and they've been operating for about 40 years, have never, ever had a staff member. So I think it is really about looking at horses for course, if you like. It's not an absolute. Some organisations can operate wonderfully as all volunteers. It's not that we always need to have volunteer management or volunteer staff to support them. I hope those comments are helpful.
Thank you very much, Dougie Glenn. They are indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. And like others have said, can I thank you for everything your organisations have done during the pandemic and coming out of this pandemic. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to financial stability and sustainability. And we've already heard about the importance of multi-year funding potentially being developed. We've seen that, and hopefully we'll hear more at today's budget along those lines. But I wanted to ask specifically, I know of cases where health boards have already tried to move towards that for some mental health charities and also for some drug services as well in the country. And I just wondered if anyone in the panel has any examples of that, or where they've seen the difference that makes and the additional capacity it can actually provide. I don't know if we want to bring Ian in, and then if anyone wants to put an R in the chat. Ian Bruce, maybe.
Thanks. I can't name any specific examples where that's being implemented at the moment. What I have seen over too many years working in the sector is repeated attempts to do it that often fall foul of later processes. So there's an attempt to do a three-year funding cycle, and then it gets to the end of that 3 years, and there's only a year's funding left in the budget, and it vanishes, and then the organisation finds itself fighting to do that again. So I think there's something about the systemic in there. There is a second bit for this for me, which is around the language that we use, because quite often we talk about three-year funding. And I think there's something in here about the risk that what that does is take the current problem and just simply makes it happen every 3 years instead of every year, which is great. But I don't think that necessarily is consistent with the parity of esteem context that we would expect with other sectors. And for me, there's something about an expectation of a rolling, a rolling sense of grant, so that at any point in time, a third set, even in the last year of a three-year grant program, there is still an indication of what the organisation will have funding and is able to take and move things forward, and be able to look a year in advance at the bare minimum. So I think there's quite a lot of complexity under what sounds like quite a simple concept that I think needs to be. And I don't think simply three-year grants that are then still renewed, minutes before the end of the financial year or the third year, is the solution in itself.
Okay, and the other Ian, I think, wanted to come in on this as well.
Yeah, thank you. Yep, thank you for that. So, yeah, I've seen some migration from the health board towards, say, some delegation of ADP funding locally, which in some sense isn't a bad thing, because we're a bit closer to the coalface than the NHS themselves, where they're based. There is a movement in the requirement to deliver services for ADP, where there's clear gaps locally. mental health support is along the exact same lines, where the need is there but the funding isn't, and therefore the onus is put onto the third sector to try and find other ways of delivering that service. And you could say the same thing in terms of community transport and the connectivity of clients getting from their home to their service providers. And I think another area that was in a sense foisted on the third sector is IJB, where there's a structure of locality planning groups, where the theory is that they gather the information and feed up to the independent joint boards, and you try and make movement there. It doesn't necessarily work out that way. It tends to be more coming from the top down. In any case, the amount of time that the third sector and volunteers and community groups are expected to spend in that with no resource whatsoever is pretty disappointing.
Thank you for that. That's helpful. My final question with regards to this was actually learnings from the pandemic. Specifically, actually, last Friday I visited North Edinburgh Arts Centre, and we were talking about the new partnerships and the new relationships which were built during the pandemic and how to sustain those. And that very much came down to that facility which was able to be utilised by them. Now, in terms of us all wanting to see additional capacity across Scotland built, do you have examples of how that's been achieved during the pandemic? And we've heard already that, to some extent, people just made things happen. There was maybe a movement away from just, risk-averse people not getting involved in things. So I just wondered if there's any examples of that. Maybe, Susie, you've got sort of a local example of that, so maybe bring you in there. And if others want to come in, put an R in the chat. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me today. I think from our experience, and a very local experience, the liberation of taking a lot of barriers away to just make things happen was fantastic. And we were able to direct our resources and working together to tackle our local response to the pandemic last year. Our particular issue was around getting food to people and dealing with that really quickly and supporting them through the first stages of the lockdown. And it was that, never mind who you work for, never mind what area you work in, how do we make this work and who's got what and who can put what in the pot. So we made that happen really quickly and with very little resource, and it made a huge difference to people. I think we were up and running before Mr Johnson made the national announcement, and then and Nicola Sturgeon. So those things happened really, really quickly. The other significant thing that helped us locally on the ground for our organisation to become a community anchor organisation and support with the supporting communities funding, and that has nurtured local partnership working in our localities really a lot faster. It's like incubated it, and things have happened as a result of that and are continuing to happen, because as a community anchor organisation, we had the access to funding to distribute amongst the partnerships and to kind of make those partnerships grow. And because of that, having that access to that funding to do things immediately just absolutely sprouted lots of ideas and made things happen. We're trying to do that with community recovery funding now, to a lesser degree because there isn't as much funding around. But again, it is making us collaborate more, and just having access to that little bit of resource to do that is absolutely fantastic. The partnerships between local and voluntary organisations and the growth of people who want to replicate what some communities in our area are doing, the growth in community capacity building has come about as a result of the pandemic. And I'm not sure that would have been there had it not happened.
Thank you. Did anyone else want to?
I've not got anyone in the chat box, but I was looking to follow up on one of Miles's questions there, to ask Susie how much of a challenge it has been to fundraise during the pandemic, and how useful multi-year funding would have been for you during this time.
Well, FM4ALL is a very new organisation. we're only 3 years old. We're run by volunteers, and we do have some staff that support what we do. The hunt for funding is incredibly difficult. Our own personal experiences, and it's very unique to us, is we're going through a major capital project that was put on hold for COVID, and our funding that we had secured to last through that transformation in our building and the capital works has evaporated as we've kept doing things for the pandemic and contributing to the local response. So we are now in a position where we have to start all over again and look for funding for the next 3 years after our funding runs out. So it's a constant battle looking for money. And I think that there is funding out there, but that it's hard to be, because it's very competitive. And that in the earlier panel, somebody talked about kind of one of the barriers to partnership working is actually you could be in competition with another group going for the same pot of money. So that is incredibly challenging. If there was a year-on-year-on budget, that would be heaven. But maybe that's a little bit wishful thinking. We have no locality budgets in our areas, in our community, through community planning for doing things. And when money does become available, again, you're in a competition for a limited pot of money to go across a lot of organisations. It is a very, very difficult challenge to look for money. And through the pandemic as well, looking for small pots of money, crowdfunding appeals, looking at some of the community pots of money that big businesses have put up, like Arnold Clark's and Asda Foundation and Tesco's, you're continually filling in applications to help families become connected digitally, to get Christmas food parcels out, to get warm jackets and coats for kids in local schools, because there's no access for that locally. And we're working with the schools to put that in place. And I think that's some of the things that we've managed to fill a gap that might not have been in our area. We don't know who would have done that if we hadn't done it. So it's always a challenge.
Thanks very much, Susie. Before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy for the next set of questions, I can see that Miles, Ian and Glenn are all looking to come in off the back of that. So Miles Fitt, please, followed by Ian Bruce.
Yeah, I'll make this brief. It's just to touch on the general point about funding of CAB services. There is a variability across Scotland. Some are 1 year, some are in 3 year funding cycles. Some have sufficient money to provide an adequate level of service. Others don't have that. And I think in order to be able to embrace the multi-channel approach which the service is taking, to ensure that face-to-face comes back as something which is an integral part of what we do, to make sure that we have that, more than just an important service, but we become that essential community asset, then I think having that stability of funding across Scotland would be something which would allow those things to happen. And I think the wider society will benefit from those things being in place.
Thanks, Miles. Ian Bruce, followed by Glenn Liddle, please.
Thanks. It was just off the back of Susie's point about funding, and I suppose one of the things that I would like to bring to the committee's attention is probably the number of mid-sized organisations that we work with now who have what you might regard as an excessive number of small grants, where actually things might be more manageable for everybody if they were funded from a smaller number of large grants. And we're seeing organisations, I'm talking about organisations with turnover around £200,000, and they are managing upwards of 12, 15 different grants to get to that income level. And I think that's not just about the application processes that organisations need to go through and the monitoring they need to do off the back of that, but it's the financial accounting that they have to do in the back end on an ongoing basis, and the governance that they need to do to make sure they're hitting all of the different targets that they have, that becomes really challenging. So there's something there about how the sector is funded as well.
Thank you very much. Glenn Liddle, and then I'll bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you.
funding is such a huge issue. I just wanted to make a couple of points. One, I think this kind of builds on previous points made already, just the huge resources that are expended in getting it. It's such an inefficient system. We have at least one full-time member of staff constantly looking at funding and the reporting back. That's also a huge job. And that's not to say that that's not, we shouldn't, of course we should be reporting back. I'm just pointing out that by way of a system, it's a very, very inefficient way of going about doing things. We probably, our income this year will be heading towards about £1 million. And that's probably through about 50 different funders, ranging from, you know, grants of over 100,000 to grants of £500 that all require reporting back on. Sometimes in the cold light of day, if you look at a grant and you look at the process to receive the funding and then to report back, you're actually questioning yourself on whether it was a good return on time and investment. And often it's not. How is it done? Often just by simply burning the midnight oil. That's how a lot of organisations, including ourselves, actually managed to do this. One final point I wanted to make is around perhaps reframing this. We talk about funding and money, but the work that we do is resourced in so many different ways. I'd like to think we're quite good at bringing in other resources. We have various buildings and spaces that we've managed to procure on a zero rent basis. Our VIPs that I mentioned earlier, you know, about 250 VIPs, if we were to be having to pay for that kind of resource just on living wage, that would come to a colossal amount of money, and our staff team as well. Also pulling in resources on a pro bono basis from different supporters as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Glenn. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener. The questions I have are for Miles and also for Ian again, if that's okay. In Glasgow, you'll be aware that a number of citizens' advice bureaus had faced some difficulties in funding in the past year or so. Can you tell us a little bit about the impact of that and the importance of resourcing organisations like that? And also, given the approach and the change in approach from the UK government to a three-year funding settlement, do you have any indication from local authorities or government in Scotland that they will seek to transfer that approach to your organisations, and notwithstanding the fact that 3 years is good, but more would be better?
Miles Fitt, followed by Ian Bruce, I presume.
Yeah. So I think there was a pressure put on the CB service in Glasgow. I'll be honest, I'm not best placed to answer that question. But again, I'm happy to follow up with the committee with an answer on that. But there was certainly pressures, and there was an element of having to establish how the service would be delivered with those pressures that came on. And so I'm aware of what went on, but I don't know exactly have the detail to hand. So I'm happy to follow that up without doubt after the committee session.
Thanks, Miles. Sorry, Ian, I was assuming it was Ian Bruce that Pam was looking for. Yes, it was.
Thank you. Similarly, I would need to come back before giving a lot of detail on this, but certainly as part of this Glasgow City Council's transition from its old integrated grants fund to the new Glasgow Community Fund, we did see some, not just citizens advice bureaus, but other financial inclusion organisations and wider third sector organisations either not being funded or being funded at a lower level than they had done previously. Obviously, that does create huge challenges. The city, people don't need reminded of the challenges around deprivation in the city, and the context of COVID means that demand on these services has been high. In terms of the wider context about three-year funding, I think it's, you know, the UK government's commitment is welcome, despite my early caveats remain. We can, you know, Scottish government have given made a number of the right noises around the direction of travel on three-year funding at a local level. Certainly the council's main funding programme is a three-year funding programme. But our concerns are always about, you know, how do we make sure that that still isn't just that organisation's being given a month's notice at the end, not being funded from the 1st of April. So that's currently an area that we're discussing quite extensively with the local authority about how we make sure we don't find ourselves in that position at the end of the current round. However, outside of that core funding, there are other, grants and contracts into the third sector, and they are not all from the local authority, and they are not all consistently 3 year or above arrangements.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Excuse me. Thank you, convener. I wanted to return to some of the questions I'd asked with regards to TSIs, and just wondered the panel's view on how they have operated, specifically with regards to the budgeting. Obviously, today we have the Scottish Government budget, but have you seen during the pandemic in your own areas that really come to the fore in how we are delivering support for the third sector? I don't know who specifically wants to come in on that. Maybe bring Ian in with a Glasgow perspective again.
Ian Bruce, please.
I'm not. Sorry, I wasn't unmuted. Thank you. I'm happy to come in on that. I think it's been really interesting. I think what we've felt, and genuinely a feeling for me, is that actually the value of what we do, the strategic value of what we do rather than the operational value of what we do, has been really appreciated during COVID. So TSIs have always had a key role in representing the sector locally and building their capacity around organisational development, social enterprise and volunteering. But I think what we've seen during COVID is people recognising that actually the TSIs are well placed in terms of their understanding of what's happening in the sector at a local level, their knowledge of the sector at the local level, and their relationships with the sector. And I think that's, we've started to really see that play out. Going forward, we're certainly seeing a dramatically improved relationship with the local authority in the city, with a tone that's much more around being regarded as a partner in addressing some of the challenges that the city has, and making sure we take advantage of the opportunities that come in our direction. So that stands out for me. As you'd asked in the previous panel, TSI funding is just over £8 million a year nationally. That has remained static for I think it's 11 years now, certainly at least 10 in cash terms. There is also, members may be aware, that it is also the case that the distribution of that funding nationally is not necessarily as equitable across local authority areas as you might expect. So as a comparison, in Glasgow, where the local authority would expect to receive in the region of 11 to 13% of Scottish Government spend for its activities, the TSI in Glasgow receives 5.5% of the national Scottish Government funding. So that does result in TSIs across the country having different capacities to respond to local needs.
Is there anyone else who wants to come in on that? One of the points I wanted to also return to was what you raised earlier, Glenn, with regards to Connect 4. And I suppose my question is, looking to the future and a potential reform or improvement around TSIs, how do you think we can achieve that? Because I think it is important what you outlined is how we do bring together all those four sectors. And where there's examples of that, I think that's important. But is that something we could look towards TSIs potentially helping to achieve?
Thank you for being invited to speak. What I wanted to share, I suppose, is that my experience of TSIs varies dramatically across the country. There are clearly fantastic examples of TSIs and fantastic examples of work that happens and takes place. But I think there's also issues where TSIs could make substantial improvements in how they operate. So I guess my to preface that my answer that the TSIs are starting from different points, different places in terms of their current capacity. Some TSIs I think are really well equipped and are well positioned to start to build and develop those further arrangements. Generally speaking, TSIs, from my experience, seem to be relatively well connected with the public sector, with the local authority, less so with the NHS. I think often that's it takes two to tango, and often I think the NHS doesn't quite know where or how to engage with TSIs. I think that's a challenge. In terms of the business world, I think we often, from my experience again, the focus is on social enterprise, which is absolutely fantastic. We use a social enterprise model and approach to some of our work, but in terms of the wider business and thinking about chambers of trade and commerce, I think sometimes those connections are not as strong as they could be. Again, in terms of academia, universities, colleges, I think there's work to be done there as well. Yeah, I hope that's helpful.
Thanks. I think, Ian, Bruce, did you want to come in as well?
Yeah, just to give a practical example of where we're doing that, we've been working with Glasgow University during the pandemic. We worked with Glasgow University to set up a pilot, a project called the Collaborative, which was around connecting the third sector with academia. There's recently been a report published on the success of that, which I'm happy to share with the committee. After today, we also have done some really interesting work. The review of the National Care Service, the consultation into the National Care Service. We've been working really closely with Strathclyde University and third sector organisations, as well as independent providers of social care, to look at what implications that has for the city and how we best respond to that. At the same time as working with our public sector partners. To look at at the implications for Glasgow. So I think a lot of that is definitely in scope for us.
That's very helpful. And just finally, and this is maybe something I'll put to you, Susie, as you've kind of established yourself during the pandemic as an organisation, really. But do you feel that the public health emergency has really seen the third sector let in and now are being pushed out again, or barriers are being put in place which certainly haven't been there or been taken down during the pandemic? And how do we prevent that? Because I think I know a lot of organisations who I've spoken to who have done a fantastic response during the pandemic, but now are finding it difficult to necessarily be listened to or don't have the same relationship they did have with statutory bodies. So I just wondered your opinion on that and anyone else in the panel as well.
In terms of our local authority, we work very well with them. There's mutual benefits. I would probably say that we can sometimes be of more benefit to our local authority and their support teams than they are actually to us. We have very, very little contact with our health and social care partnership, and that's considering our initial work is all about health and wellbeing in our communities. That's quite sad, and we don't know where the door is to get in. So, yeah, that's all I can say on that one.
Thank you. Ian McNeill, you're looking to come in at this point.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I think the Western Isles example would be that it took us a wee while to establish ourselves as a real player and a real partner in that, in the emergency planning side of things. We brought quite a lot of issues to the fore, but it took us a while to get accepted. And a lot of it was around issues of confidentiality and things like that. But once we got those barriers out the way, we were accepted as a good partner. And I've seen since then some good work and some more inclusive agendas. So I think the pandemic's probably brought a good few of us closer together, and I hope that continues.
Thank you very much indeed, Ian. Marie McNair, followed by Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thanks, Convener. A lot of funding comes from local councils. Can you highlight any good practice you're aware of by local councils in their financial support to the third sector? I'll put that first to Miles and anyone else who would want to come in and comment on that.
I can't really give you any details on this, other than a general statement that the councils fund local bureaus. And in some areas, the relationships are good, some less so in other areas. The level of funding will vary across Scotland. There are partnerships that go on, but I wouldn't want to give any detail at this stage because I don't want to give you the wrong information. So, again, I'm happy to follow up with the committee afterwards.
Nobody else looking to come in at this stage, Marie? Oh, Glenn Liddle. Sorry, Glenn.
Thank you. Can I speak from our perspective as a charity? We set up projects and services often with multiple streams of funding. So often there'll be public sector funding, whether that be through a local authority, through NHS, but we always put that together with other funding from trusts, foundations, the lottery, some of the kind of household names of big funders that you all know. I think that's that often the funding can unlock other funding in terms of match funding. So often a local authority will think, okay, if we fund that, that will build and add capacity. And likewise, if a local authority has funded an initial piece of work or the NHS has funded an initial piece of work where we can gather additional funding, that builds capacity. So my the question started with a lot of funding comes from the councils. I just want to make the point that a lot of funding comes from elsewhere as well. And also to make the point around resources in the shape of our volunteers, interns, placement students, spaces, buildings, pro bono support, support from universities that can be very, very, very real and quite sizable.
Ian McNeill, I can see you're looking to come in again briefly, and then I'll take in Jeremy Balfour.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Just to highlight one of the funds that the Council has worked with the community through local wards is the Crown Estate Funds. Crown Estate Funds in the Western Isles and our communities have had good access to the schemes that have been rolled out so far.
Thank you very much. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Good morning. Just two quick questions, maybe. If I can start with Ian for this question. It's a similar question you asked the other panel. Just looking for lessons learned from last year, do you think from talking to the people that you're involved with that the money that came from Scottish Government and UK Government got down to the charities that were dealing with the most need on the ground? And is that? Did you hear any stories that it got kind of blocked with either larger charities or it didn't get to the people that were actually doing the work?
I think a few things here. I suppose I'll start by making clear that I think considering the pace that everything happened at, I think that worked very well, all things considered. But I will highlight just a couple of areas where we think things might have been a little bit more effective. But it is genuinely said with the absolute benefit of hindsight. We found locally when we spoke, what we found was that there were some organisations that were excluded, and it wasn't. I don't think it was deliberate. It was done with very good intentions. So we found in the city that the city has a very high, compared to the rest of Scotland, a very high BME population. Many of the organisations that are best placed to reach that population are very small and volunteer-led. And the Wellbeing Fund from Scottish Government required a minimum grant of £5,000, which in itself seems very reasonable, but it also required that applicants apply for no more than, and I'm going to say 25%, but if the committee can forgive me if that's not the right figure, 25% of their normal annual income. What that actually meant was that organisations, if my maths are right, the organisations with an income of under £20,000 were excluded from applying, and the overwhelming majority of those BME organisations fell into that category. So I think you know, later interventions tried to address that, but there were some bits. I think the second thing I'll say is that there wasn't necessarily other huge gaps in organisations getting money. What I think we probably saw, though, was the approach, and again, probably necessary at the time, but it probably didn't result in the best use of money and the best coverage in the city. And what we got was a little bit of feedback from some communities that what was happening is that people were actually getting, you know, in terms of things like food parcels, people were actually getting multiple food parcels delivered from different providers. You know, probably, you know, and I think that that's a little bit of a reflection. You know, how do we take in future, how do we take more of an emergency response approach rather than one that was effectively predicated on a faster version of a usual grants program? But I do want to triple emphasize all of these things are really easily said with hindsight.
Thank you, and that's helpful. I am very conscious of time, so if I can just move on to one other area, maybe aim this at either Glenn or Susie or both for maybe a quite a brief answer. And that is just around the whole issue of your relationship with Oscar. There's likely to be brought forward reform of charity law within the next 5 years. Do you think there's things that you would want to see changed? Is it over bureaucratic, the number of forms you have to fill in, or do you think it's about right? And maybe start with Glenn.
This was quite a quick answer from our perspective. I don't find the reporting back to Oscar overly burdensome. As an organisation, we have grown quite dramatically. What has been a challenge is that in terms of accounting rules, that's changed dramatically. You know, going from our first year's accounts were £5,000. We're just about to sign off on accounts that will be heading towards £1 million. But that's a reality, and that's as it should be, that of course there are more accounting processes and audits and everything else in process. One last point. I'm a great advocate of SCIOs. And I think a lot of people, a lot of charities, a lot of organisations still don't realise the benefits of a SCIO. So that can save people from being registered as a charity, but also as a company. I think there could be more work to promote SCIOs.
Very quick, Susie, as somebody who started a newer charity, how's the relationship been? Oh, you're on mute.
I have to say the support we got from Oscar in setting up, we were a bit worried about timescales, but we actually found the whole process very quick. The reporting process for us at the moment is not burdensome. It's very easy to do, and it's very easy to put online, and it's very transparent to our members and community. I like Glenn, we are a growing organisation, and we realise that the kind of governance around accounting will increase for us, but we'll grow with that as our organisation grows. But so far, we've found the our work for Oscar not overburdensome at all.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'd like to bring in Evelyn Tweed now, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for all your contributions so far. They've been really helpful. My questions are around recovery and renewal, and I know that you've spoken about some of the things probably in your previous answers, but how can we ensure that the third sector are at the heart of social and economic recovery? What can local authorities, UK and the Scottish Government do to ensure that this happens? And can I direct that question in the first instance to Ian Bruce, please?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a number of things that stand out for me. I think first of all, it's worth saying that actually what's really important is actually that recognition of the third sector's role in the economic recovery. And this is probably the first time that I've seen a
there's currently consultation happening on the Scottish Government's economic strategy, and it's the first time I really feel that the third sector has been seen as an economic force in its own right, which I think is really positive. There are a number of things for me. The first and foremost, probably for me, is around the focus on the local, and I mean the local. We often think about local, and I think people drift to thinking about local authority areas. But when you look at a city the size of Glasgow, actually local means something much closer to home. And my sense is that the closer you get down into communities, the more obvious the role of the third sector becomes. And it's when we look at things in the abstract and the national and the regional that it becomes easy to ignore or forget the third sector's contribution. But actually in my own area, I live in the Gorbals in the city. And when you're in the Gorbals in the city, what you actually see is the impact of third sector organisations on the lives of people on a daily basis. And so I think there's something very much for me around how we plan services and how we commission things at a really local level that really will ensure that the third sector is best placed to participate.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to come in that one, or will I just...
Susie Burt is looking to come in. I'd like to be brief if that's possible, please.
Yes. I would make a plea for some kind of plan. We're working really hard on the ground to support people to recover in terms of mental health, in terms of wealth and well-being, about employability and all aspects of their life. But we're going on our gut knowledge and our knowledge of our community, but we don't see where that feeds into any kind of plan at the moment in our area in terms of recovery. And again, I think that having some way of bringing us together, and I don't know if that's a TSI role locally or if it's through community planning, but there's nothing that actually pulls us all together to make sure we're not duplicating and we're making best use of resources around recovery.
I can see that Glenn and Ian would also look, and Miles would also look to make very brief contributions there, please.
Thank you. I'm going to repeat some of the things that I said earlier. Three points to get away from silo working. We're still seeing a lot of, I see you're nodding already. I don't need to elaborate on that point. My other point I made earlier as well was around what I call the first aid approach, and that actually there's often a lack of opportunity or desire to genuinely change things at the system level. I think that feeds into my third point around the power dynamic and the parity of esteem. How often do people see the third sector in a position of leadership? Often the third sector is seen as working with the public sector at best. When we're actually asked, sometimes we come up with things that weren't expected and maybe kind of pushed to one side because it wasn't quite the right answer. So I think that just feeds into the whole issue around the power dynamics and parity of esteem. If you really want collaboration and partnership working, that's got to come from both sides, and people need to be prepared to change and to modify their views, their opinions, their outlook. Otherwise, that's not a genuine partnership if both sides are not prepared to change. We just look at what makes personal relationships work. We have to have a bit of give and take. Thank you.
Thanks, Glenn. Miles, briefly, and Ian McNeill, please.
Yeah, it's just to go on the point about the economic strategy and economic contribution of the volunteers of the third sector from that CBE perspective. You know, I did touch on before about how organisations like Cab Service can bring volunteers in, give them my experience, then go into the workforce and make that contribution to the economic situation. I think I'd also say that the Cab Service helps people to unlock money. We basically, last year, £147 million was kind of unlocked for people, but from the advice we gave, and that goes back into the local community, that goes back into the economics of the local community. So there is a valuable role, not just in the service provision, but also in how we can contribute to the economic recovery. And I think it's important the third sector stays fully involved in that. And I think there'll be many other examples across the third sector where this economic output and financial output back into the community will take place.
Thank you. Ian McNeill, briefly, please.
Just to say, social and economic renewal, in my opinion, has to start at the community level, right at that baseline. And the third sector have got a big role in helping to drive that forward, possibly through social and economic forums, which include partner agencies and local authorities.
Thank you very much. Evelyn, did you have another brief question?
One more quick one, if that's okay, convener. To Miles Fitt, please. How can we make sure there is partnership and cooperation in the third sector if organisations are constantly competing for funding against each other and contracts? And is there a more holistic way to look at this?
I think there is. I can't properly answer at this session, and I'll follow up. But again, other than say a general response of yes, I think a recognition that the organisations involved are seeking the same outcomes. So the ability for organisations to focus on that and to align resources which get to the best outcome, but recognise the roles that each individual partner would play would be a basic answer to your question. But I'm happy to follow up afterwards with a bit more detail for you.
Thank you very much. That would be very helpful. I'm sorry to say that is the end of our session. If there is anything that anybody on the panel would have wanted to say but didn't manage to get across, I'd be very keen to hear that and see that in writing. I have a couple of one question that I'd be keen for you to do that. And if that's possible, please, and that's around digital exclusion, both in terms of the people that you're providing services to, so how challenging that has been, accessing digital services have been for the people you're providing services to, but also as organisations, whether or not you've been able to access your platforms, been able to support your members and been able to facilitate the services that you're providing as well. And if there's anything further that can be done to support that from government or indeed local authority level, that would be very helpful, please. In the meantime, I want to say thank you very much to you all for your time this morning and also for the work that you and your organisations have been doing during the pandemic and as we continue out of it. It's greatly appreciated. Thank you very much indeed. I'd now like to move on to the next item on the agenda, please, which is where the committee is invited to consider the following negative instrument, the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Amendment No. 5, Regulations 2021. Background to these regulations are outlined in Paper 9. Do members have any comments they would like to raise in relation to these regulations? No. Are members therefore content to note the instrument? Thank you very much indeed. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. The next committee, next week, the committee will take evidence on the proposed adult disability payment regulations. And I would like to suspend the meeting now and move to a private session. I would like to invite colleagues joining us remotely to leave the meeting and join the private session via the link provided. Thank you very much indeed.